Hey, thanks for clicking on the extended version of my cast interviews for the new James Bond film, Spectre. You're looking at the Palacio de Bellas Artes, one of the most beautiful buildings here in Mexico City. And we talked to Bond himself, Daniel Craig, plus some beautiful women, the Bond ladies, and the bad guy, Christoph Waltz.
You had no authority. None. Mexico City. What were you doing there?
I was taking some overdue holiday.
When was the last time you actually had a holiday?
I just had one.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, when we finished the film. And I spent 2 weeks in Spain.
I was going to say, do you ever get to enjoy the locales? You've been all over shooting these movies.
You kind of do. I mean, it's an interesting one because as a tourist, you obviously see certain aspects of a place. But when you're filming, you get to see a little more because you get to work with local people and you get to get a bit more involved with a city like this. I mean, this is an extraordinary place. Mexico City is one of the most beautiful, exciting cities I've ever been to in my life.
Lots of traffic.
Well, you know, modern life. What are you going to do?
So, James, why did you come?
I came here to kill you.
And I thought you came here to die.
Well, it's all a matter of perspective.
You were sworn to secrecy with this part. Are you good at keeping secrets?
Very good.
Yeah.
I'm a very discreet person, I'm proud to say. You can tell me the most sensational, outrageous thing. If you tell me, please don't tell anyone, I wouldn't even tell my wife.
Really?
Really.
Has she tried hard to get it out of you, though, or?
No, she knows. It's hopeless. I can say that the last shot in the movie made me jump out of joy. It was fun. It's a spectacle. It's suspenseful. It's, you know, even if you want to think a little bit, you can. You don't have to, but if you choose to, you even get your money's worth.
If you don't leave now, we'll die together.
I can think of worse ways to go.
You meet him at a funeral. Not the best first place to meet.
Yeah, but maybe because she comes from death and she needs a transformation in her life, and Bond is going to save her from this darkness. Even though she is a short role, but it's a key role because she's going to give informations to Bond, and through those informations, the mission can begin, actually.
You accomplish a lot in a few minutes. Let's just leave it at that. A lot of people, I don't know why they're talking about the age thing. You know, a lot of people are talking about your age as a Bond girl. I'll take 50s any day if this is what I can look like.
Thank you. I think it's Mendes' idea. And when I met him, I was a bit surprised. And I said, what am I going to do at 50 years old with James Bond? But actually said, I like the idea to have a mature woman for the first time in the Bond history. And I think that this woman, even though she doesn't have the beauty of the youth anymore, but she still have as her femininity, and this femininity is going to save her.
I think she has the beauty of youth. What do you think?
Yeah, she's the beauty.
Yeah.
Oh, God, she's the beauty.
What's this?
It's coordinates.
She's not like the usual Bond girl. She doesn't, I mean, she even her clothes are very simple. So I think they wanted to portray a woman who's more, not a girl next door, but, you know, more like, I think women can really relay to her. So, yeah, I think it's good. And it's good to not have, like, the cliché Bond girl, you know, who's in bathing suit or, you know, she has a brain, so.
Yeah, no bathing suits,
no.
But negligee.
Yeah.
Underwear. Bra.
Yeah.
So it's still there. Something.
Something.
I did not know your name until very end. Tell us, what can you say about Mr. Hanks? What's his backstory?
Oh, that's funny.
He's not a talker.
Yeah, he's definitely not a talker. He's a man of limited words. He's not necessarily a man of a limited thought, but he's definitely a man of limited words. You know, I don't know, as far as I see the character, he's, you know, he was assassinating people when he was 5 years old.
In your head, is he dating at least? Does he have a girlfriend?
No, you know, I don't know. I don't think so. I don't think Hinks would have time for a girl. I don't think he would make the emotional investment, you know? I'm sure he has his fun, But I think he would spend most of his time, his off time, when he's not assassinating people or chasing James Bond, you know, being manicured and groomed and being fitted for suits and being getting his shoes shined and getting his nails polished up.
He's busy. He's got stuff to do.
He's a man of leisure.
Did you ever mess up and accidentally add some dialogue when you weren't supposed to have dialogue?
No. No, not at all. I kind of relished in this character. I was really kind of excited that he wasn't silent. It takes a little bit of the pressure off.
Yeah. And it harkens back to the old, I saw Jaws in this. I loved it.
Well, that's the thing. That's the connection. And that was what he was going for. And I knew that's what, as soon as Sam described the character to me, I got it right off the bat. Yeah. Because I had those fond memories and I connected and I didn't need to be, I didn't need to have the dialogue. I don't think, nothing needs to be said from Hinks. Yeah. You know, it does all his speaking physically. But you're right, I made that connection, and that character hasn't been done since Jaws.
I agree.
So I'm really excited about this.
Me too. We should have done the whole interview just looking at each other. We didn't even need to speak. We would have accomplished so much.
I may have done this every once in a while.
Yeah. You were not on the train. You were involved in the train scene. How many walls came down shooting that thing?
In the train, it was great. Yeah, we rehearsed and, learned the choreography and everything. But it was a lot of fun, yeah.
They're saying that Daniel actually almost broke Dave's nose. Were you there for that?
Yeah, and he hurt it. He's seen.
What does an almost broken nose sound like?
How
like
is
crack?
The noise? Like
Oh, that actually was pretty good.
That what you did in Mexico was one step too far. That you're finished.
What do you think?
I think you're just getting started.
You've talked a lot about the perks of being Bond. Has there been an instance where being Bond actually didn't work in your favor?
I don't know. If there were, they've been far outweighed by the pluses. You know,
sure.
It's there are things you get that come with the territory, but I don't know what I mean. There are too many good things.
What's the weirdest place you've been recognized?
Mongolia.
Seriously?
Yeah.
Like in the middle of nowhere?
Middle of nowhere.
How did it happen?
I was there with a charity, Orbis, which is an eye charity I support, and we were out in the middle of nowhere and somebody recognized me. In fact, they started following us. I was at a meeting recently and your name came up.
I'm flattered London are still talking about me.
It wasn't MI6.
You're a kite dancing in a hurricane, Mr. Bond.
Do you ever sit in a theater and get popcorn and watch these things?
I mean, I watch other movies like that. I don't tend to do that with this movie, but I don't tend to watch my stuff very much. So I like to, when we're on the road and we're showing it to different audiences, I like to sit in for the first 5 minutes sometimes and just gauge your reaction. It's always nicer. The reason we make these films for an audience. I mean, all this sort of, this is lovely talking to you guys and doing all of this, but it's they're the people that only matter. And how they react is especially to the opening sequence in this movie, which is pretty good.
Hope you enjoyed my cast interviews for the new Bond film Spectre. The opening sequence set right here in Mexico City. That's where we are, Harkins on location. Don't forget to like us on Facebook, Harkins Theaters, for your movie news, promotions, and giveaways. In the meantime, I'm going to do some sightseeing. We'll see you at the theater.